ESPN and ACC Extra. The 1-0 is fouled out of here left side into the screen and bounces back down along the third baseline, where Elton Pollock, head coach in his 20th season, picks it up and rolls it back to the dugout. John O'Neill coaching down at first base. There's a strike called on the outside corner, and LeGurnick now ahead, 1-2. Umpires, Doug Vines behind the plate, Craig Barron at first, Barry Chambers at second, John Byrne at third. The lefty's 1-2 pitch, and strike three swing and got him to chase the pitch way off the plate outside. And a good start for the Clemson freshman left-hander Justin LeGurnick. Defensively for the Tigers, Jack Crichton at first, Jaron Purify at second, Jacob Hinderleiter at short, and Blake Wright at third. In the outfield left to right, Will Taylor, Alden Mathis, and Tristan Bassetta. Jimmy Overtop is behind the plate. One down for Brody Farr, the shortstop. He takes it inside a ball. This is a Blue Hose team hitting 248 as a unit coming in. And two of their anticipated big-time performers this season out for the year, Amon Dewberry and Trey Fenderson, corner infielders, both done for the year. In fact, Fenderson played the opener, and that's the only game he saw this season. And they have a third infielder who has been out for an extended period of time, and Jack Gorman. But the good news for the Blue Hose is he is on his way back. In fact, we saw him working out taking ground balls earlier today. 3-2 is that pitch just missed off the plate outside. But what that's done for Elton Pollock is put some youngsters in some places where they're being asked to perform early. There's ball four high and away, and Farr is a one-out base runner. So a strikeout and a walk for LeGurnick. Probably help if we turn the crowd mic back down after the national anthem was done. Sunny, 74 degrees as we get things underway here at Fluor Field. Crowd still making its way in. Part of the college baseball series here as Joel Dragoo takes a strike. He's hitting 446. A junior center fielder with six homers and 30 runs batted in. All of those numbers tops on this Blue Hose team. And there's a balk as LeGurnick started and stopped. And that will advance Brody Farr to second base. You can tell by the shadows when we get the high home plate shot, the right side of the infield and right field, the sun fields here, the shadows move out from the third baseline out. So it will be an issue for a while. No balls and two strikes to Dragoo. LeGurnick pitching, and he missed low. 1-2. PC coming off of a three-game series sweep at the hands of George Washington this past weekend. Trying to regain some momentum. But when they get into Big South play, and they had the bye week as far as league play goes on opening weekend, so that's why they were playing George Washington last week. They'll get headlong into conference play against Longwood on Friday. But what is carrying them right now, especially with all of the injuries, is their pitching staff. Overall, they've got a 3.73 staff ERA coming into play through 20 games. 3-2 pitch is fouled out of play right side. And their two weekend starters, their first two weekend starters, Daniel Egan and Charlie McDaniel, are both considered prime draft prospects, especially Egan. Again, the payoff, and just missed the inside corner. So after the strikeout, back-to-back walks issued by Lagernick to Farr and Dragoo, and now Rogue Wallace will bat with two on and one out. But Egan was voted the top prospect in all of the Big South coming into the season. Fastball that sits in the mid-90s. Elton Pollock telling me before the game that expects him to be drafted and drafted fairly high. Wallace fouls the first pitch off to the right. No balls in a strike. Hitting 191. He's homered once. Driven in three runs. Switch hitter. Might be a switch hatter too. I don't know. But a switch hitter batting right-handed against the lefty Lagernick. And it's 1-1. And time called. That's going to get catcher Jimmy Obertop out to try and settle down his young lefty. Struck out Weatherington to begin things. Walked far. Got ahead 0-2 on Dragoo, but ended up walking him. And now 1-1 on Wallace with Jackson Hugus, the catcher, waiting on deck. So a PC team that right now is struggling for consistency on offense, an opportunity here early. And that breaking ball hit back into left center field. Mathis back to the track and a couple of steps from the wall. Reaches up and makes the catch. Tagging up and moving to third as far. And they're on the corners now with two down for the aforementioned Jackson Hugus. Tell you what, Wallace didn't miss by much of getting that ball out of here. Watching it from our perch high behind home plate, it looked like he may have been just a little bit out in front of the ball, but still hit it a long way. So now Hugus, a 286 batter, he's driven in five runs, looking to do damage here with two outs. Hitting just 167 with runners in scoring position on the year. Teammates on the corners, and Lagernick's fastball is outside. Stuff is not an issue for this young man. Fastball low 90s. This finding consistent command has been the issue early in his freshman season. Comes from an arm slot that's kind of between three quarters and sidearm. And you can see where especially opposing left-handed batters would have a hard time hitting him, but can't get it over the plate. As he's struggling to do here, he's now down three balls and no strikes. It's a hard way to make a living, consistently pitching behind and giving the opposition free base runners. See if Hugus is taking the 3-0 pitch. And he is, and it's a fastball strike, 3-1. Brody Farr at third, he walked with one out. Joel Dragoo at first. He followed the far walk with a base on balls of his own, and now 3-1 to Hugus. Runner at first goes. It's taken for a strike, and just basically ignore him and let Dragoo coast into second base with the unchallenged steal. That's his second of the season in as many tries. So now a two-out hit could bring home a pair of runs. Lagernick trying to come all the way back. The payoff, and he struck him out swinging. Got him to chase a fastball up and away. And that's got to be it. And this lefty-lefty matchup, and the first pitch to him is in there for a strike. Mid-80s is where Charlin Boos is going to sit. Fastball, slider, cutter. Occasional change, won't throw it very often. And that ball's hit down the right field line. That is going to curve foul. It's a good time to talk about the dimensions in this Fenway Park replica. That is 300 feet to the foul pole, known as the pesky pole. But then that wall that immediately curves and juts backwards. 420 to the triangle out in center field, the deepest part of the ballpark. Here's the 0-2 pitch, and strike three called. And three pitches and see you later for Alden Mathis, one down. 3-10 to the Green Monster down the line in left field. 30 feet here, it's 37 in Fenway. Defensively for the Blue Holes, Holden Baker at first. Aaron Hobson at second, Brody Farr at short, Eli Lazio at third. In the outfield left to right, Jay Weatherington, Joel Dragoo, and Rogue Wallace, Jackson Hugus behind the plate. Home plate umpire Doug Vines holding things up for a moment. Now tells Charlin Boos he can go, and his first pitch to Overtop is a fastball for a strike. Senior catcher hitting 328. He's homered four times, knocked in 15 runs. Tigers giving a couple of their regulars a night off tonight, at least at game's beginning. Down and inside, 1-1. Cam Cannarella, who has started the previous 19 games, have been battling a bit of a shoulder issue. So they're giving him the night off with Florida State coming up at Doug Kingsmore Stadium this weekend. Big bounding ball foul down the third baseline. And Andrew Schufo has also started the previous 19 games. He's been scuffling just a bit, so he gets a chance to rest tonight. One ball and two strikes to Overtop with Blake Wright waiting on deck. The 1-2 pitch. And he tried the inside corner and missed. 2-2. Looks like there's going to be a decent crowd here at Fluor Field tonight. We had South Carolina and USC Upstate in the ballpark yesterday and had just over 1,800 for that one. 2-2 pitch. Fouled to the backstop. Looks like tonight's crowd is headed in that direction, maybe a little north of that. Weather is a lot better. 74 degrees at first pitch tonight. It's 58 when we got started last night, the same 6 o'clock start time. 2-2 pitch. Strike three called. Outside corner, and Overtop knew it. Two down. Back-to-back punch-outs for Charlin Boos. And that'll bring Blake Wright to the plate. Three seniors at the top of the order for Eric Backich tonight. And Wright is having a fine start to this 2024 season. 337. Seven home runs and 22 runs batted in. And the first pitch high and away, ball one. Presbyterian College got two on with two out in the top of the inning, couldn't score. Charlin Boos trying to set Clemson down in order in the bottom of the inning, and that changeup floats way outside. Two balls and no strikes. Tristan Bassetta hoping to get a shot. He's in the on-deck circle. Second baseman Hobson, a couple of steps on the grass and almost directly behind the bag for the right-handed hitter, and there's ball three outside. Clemson will be back at Fluor Field on April the 2nd to face USC Upstate. There's strike one called, 3-1. And then, except for the Southern Conference baseball tournament in May, that will wrap up what's been just a fantastic start to the season as far as college baseball is concerned here in this beautiful facility. There's ball four down and in, and Wright is a two-out base runner. The Greenville Drive season, the home season, begins on April the 9th. The Drive, a high-A affiliate of the Boston Red Sox and the reigning South Atlantic League champions. Now here is Tristan Bassetta. And this guy perhaps has been the story of the early season for Eric Backich's team. Big, strong left-handed batter hitting 379. He's homered three times, driven in 11 runs. His ninth start in their first 20 games, but once he got into the lineup, he has basically hit so well that they've not been able to take him out. Big swing and a miss there, and he's down 0-2. He has talking with William Quackenbush, who's doing Clemson radio tonight with Brad Owens, saying that he's a guy who's come from literally off the radar and has forced his way into, as you can see tonight, batting cleanup. No balls and two strikes. Two outs, runner at first for the Tigers. Long pause and the pitch. And it's low. 1-2. Will Taylor will be next. If Bassetta can keep the inning alive. Center fielder Dragoo playing him just a step or two towards right. Second baseman Hobson out on the grass. Runner goes, but a swing and a miss for strike three, and the inning is over. So Charlenbusch strikes out three in the inning. Here's Ryan Becker leading it off. And the first pitch from Lagernick is in there for a strike. Say hello to Chris Sloan, who shot me a message a moment ago, and my buddy David Garrett. From the Life FM. Foul straight back. No balls and two strikes. Becker hitting 184. He's driven in six runs. Sophomore DH for Elton Pollock tonight. Had a really good long conversation with Elton down just before PC took batting practice today as Clemson was finishing up. There's strike three swinging. Third strikeout for Lagernick, and one down for Holden Baker. He's in his 20th season, and I would say still as spry as he was the day he walked on campus. Swing and a miss at a fastball up by Baker, a 167 batting freshman with a single run batted in on the season. This is his first start. Only the sixth game he's played in so far. And this is a tough matchup for him against this young, talented, but erratic left-hander. Justin Lagernick takes a strike. It's 0-2. And way outside with that one, a ball and two strikes. But you never know what getting out of a jam like he did in the first inning might do for someone's confidence. Comes the 1-2 pitch, and it's tap foul. I was talking with Elton going back to a couple of years before he took over as head coach at PC. He's in his 20th season, but talking about working Jack Leggett's baseball camp over at Clemson about 22 years ago. 1-2 pitch, up and in, and down goes Baker. 2-2. And said that at that time, Tim Corbin was Jack's offensive assistant. You know what he's done since going on to Vanderbilt. There's strike three swinging. That's three straight punch-outs for Lagernick, two down. But Elton told me that after the first day at camp, a bunch of the other coaches were heading over toward the Esso Club. They were going to go relax, we'll say. And Corbin walked up to him and one of the other coaches working the camp and handed him a brochure or a pack of papers about an inch thick and said, this is what we're going to work on tomorrow, so you need to know what we're doing. No Esso Club for Elton. He spent the night studying so he knew what was going to happen at that camp tomorrow. Or the next day. Down and in to Aaron Hobson. One ball and one strike. But you think about that staff that Jack Leggett had at one time at Clemson. Line drive, base hit into right field. Nice inside-out swing on a pitch in on the fists. And Hobson goes the other way for a two-out hit, first for either team. He's a two-out base runner. Tim Corbin was his lead assistant. He's gone on to Vanderbilt, national championship coach, Hall of Famer now. guy named Kevin O'Sullivan went on to the University of Florida, where he still is, championship, high-level coach. John Pawlowski was on Jack Leggett's staff at one time, highly successful at the College of Charleston. He went on to Auburn for a stretch. Tom Reginas, who is still the head coach at Winthrop and has been for 12 or 13 years. Runner goes, pitch is taken down and in, and the throw skips into center field, but no further advancement by Hobson. Stolen base for him. That is his fifth of the season. He's yet to be caught. And he's in scoring position in a two-ball, no-strike count to Eli Lazio. Junior hitting just 156. He's homered once and driven in two runs. Second straight inning that PC's had a runner in scoring position with two down. And Lagernick bounces that one up there, ball three. Lazio just 111 so far this season with runners in scoring position. His 16th start of the year. 3-0 pitch. Took something off that one and got it in at the knees, 3-1. And, of course, the best news as far as I'm concerned, having covered Clemson as a writer and a broadcaster for over a decade, as that ball's fouled off, is that when Eric Backich was hired to replace Monty Lee in the summer of 2022, the first thing he did was bring Jack Leggett back into the program. And number seven was the first Tiger in the ballpark here today. 3-2 pitch, and he walked him. So down to first goes Lazio, two on with two out again, and back to the top of the order for Jay Weatherington, who struck out swinging his first time up. So if you're keeping tabs so far, as Jimmy, good to catch up with him down on the field before the game today. All right, meeting over. Here's Weatherington, and the first pitch from Lagernick in the dirt, ball one. Good number of fans taking in the game from the green monster seats. About three quarters full. Outside, two balls and no strikes. Bullpens here are located behind the outfield fence, so it's usually next to impossible to know if anybody's warming up. The only way we can tell is when the catcher lobs the ball back to the pitcher who's throwing and it goes above the horizon of the fence. There's a wild one off the mitt of Weatherington, and both runners will advance. Hobson to third and Lazio to second. So three balls and no strikes. And again, second and third with two outs for the second straight inning for the Blue Hose. No score as we play here in the top of the second. And Lagernick pitching. And he got the outside corner, strike one. Actually, they are going to score that a passed ball on the catcher, Jimmy Obertop. 3-1, swing and a foul off of Obertop, rolling to the right of home plate. And so Lagernick has come back to run it full at 3-2. Top two hitters in this PC lineup follow Weatherington, Farr, and Dragoo respectively. Payoff pitch, and he struck him out swinging. Came all the way back to get him. He'll be followed by Jacob Hinderleiter and Cooper Blauser. And the first pitch to Taylor is in for a strike. Taylor hitting 208, five home runs, nine runs batted in. Big swing and a foul back. And until last night, had one of the more odd stat lines that you'll see. He had five home runs and five runs batted in. All five of his home runs have been solo shots, but he drove in four runs last night, and he takes a breaking ball, strike three called, and goes back to the dugout, bat in hand. On-base percentage is high, the batting average not at 208. They're waiting for him to get completely untracked now that he has given up football and concentrating solely on baseball. They feel like that's just a matter of time. One down. Here is Hinderleiter, senior shortstop, batting 274, and he is ahead, one ball and no strikes. And there's ball two, bounces up there. Hampton, like many relievers, works from the stretch full time. Scoreless here in the bottom of the second inning. Right-hander bringing it. And it's ball three as he missed low, and it squirts through the legs of Hugus. Three balls, no strikes. Hinderleiter back in. Cooper Blauser on deck. And there's strike one on the inside corner. Say hello to my buddy Chris Carter. I've spent quite a few afternoons and evenings in a baseball press box with him over the years. Ball four high. And Hinderleiter, a one-out base runner. And here's freshman DH Cooper Blauser. Blauser making his fifth start, eighth game appearance. 125 on the season, 2-for-16, but one of those two hits, a home run, the other one a double. He's driven in a pair of runs. First pitch outside a ball. Decent lead at first for Hinderleiter. He's running. Pitch taken for a strike. The throw down not nearly in time. Easy stolen base for the Clemson shortstop. He's 4-for-4 on the season. First Tiger to get in scoring position with one out here in the second inning. One ball and one strike on Blauser. Field straight away for him. And Hampton pitching. Runner goes again. Pitch is taken for a strike. Throw to third. Again, way late. Back-to-back stolen bases for Hinderleiter. He's now 90 feet away with one out, but a 1-2 count on Blauser. Hampton pitching, and a fly ball. Right field, backing on it is Wallace. That'll be plenty deep enough to get the run in. He makes the catch. Coming in without a throw is Hinderleiter. Sacrifice fly for Blauser, and Clemson takes the early 1-0 lead. Third RBI of the season. That's a good bit of hitting. You're down 1-2 in the count. You got the runner at third with less than two outs. You just put it in play and make something happen, and that's what Blauser did. Two out, bases empty for Jack Crichton. 345 batting sophomore first baseman, and he takes the first pitch just off the outside edge, ball one. This is ninth start of the season. No homers, two RBIs. He's doubled twice, and that breaking ball just missed outside. Two and oh. goes 2-0 breaking ball, and he drops it in for a strike, 2-1. Say hello to Ed in nearby Salem, South Carolina. He's watching the broadcast this evening. That ball is popped foul and out of play down the right field line. Ed Jennings watching from Allentown, Pennsylvania. 1979 Clemson grad in the house. And there is a looping line drive foul just outside of first. And the count holds at 2-2. And Travis Thompson from up the road in Inman, South Carolina, checking in via email. Drivebooth@yahoo.com. 2-2 pitch. Low with the fastball, ball three. One nothing Clemson. Tigers have scored a run here in the second inning. And he dropped the breaking ball on the inside corner, strike three. Crichton was on his way to first, but so it is Ethan Darden coming on, and he'll get 2, 3, and 4 in the PC lineup, beginning with the shortstop, Brody Farr, who walked his first time up. Joining us in the booth is the esteemed general manager of the Greenville Drive, the high A affiliate of the Boston Red Sox, who has thrown his shoulder out of joint by wearing that South Atlantic League championship ring all over the place. Eric Jurinko, how are you, sir?
I'm good, Dan. Thanks for having me on.
Swing and a miss, and Darden makes quick work of Brody Farr. One down, six strikeout already for Clemson pitching. A little bit better weather tonight than we had here last night.
Yeah, a little bit. I hope this weather carries over into April.
One of the things that I love about what the Greenville Drive does, and Lord allows me to see April 9th, I'll begin my sixth season as the voice of the drive. No balls and a strike to Dragoo, and now it's 0-2. Is you've got a beautiful ballpark, Fenway replica, but this organization does not rest on its laurels. Every year there's something different to improve the fan experience.
Yeah, that's really important to us, and it's not just the fan experience, it's the experience for the players too, whether it's college athletes like tonight or high school athletes, because we do have a lot of high school games here as well, or even our drive players. And credit to our ownership group and in making sure that the product stays fresh every year, whether that's new fan amenities, or last year we spent $8 million or so in upgrades to the locker room area. Heading into this year, our two biggest upgrades have been the field lighting, which benefits both the players and the fans with everything that comes with that.
High bounding ball up the middle. Nice play by Hinderleiter, sweeping to his left, smoothly throwing him out, and they're two down.
And we've spent a lot of time on kind of just upgrading our concessions product throughout the stadium as well.
Yeah, I had the little fan experience here a month and a half ago and broke out a little Philly cheesesteak.
Yeah.
And my wife was particularly happy to get the lobster rolls. She's a seafood freak.
Yeah, that was. We've got a great executive chef. I mean, it's pretty uncommon for a minor league baseball team to have an executive chef, but Sammy Dominguez does an amazing job, the rest of our food and beverage team. And yeah, it was important for us to add a lobster roll to kind of bring that Fenway authenticity. And they wanted to do a cheesesteak, and I'm originally from Philly, so I said, you've got the harshest critic you're going to have to deal with on those, and they did a pretty good job.
Two balls and no strikes on Rogue Wallace, now 3-0 as Darden misses inside. Two outs, nobody on. 1-0 Clemson as we play here in the top of the third inning. Presbyterian College at the plate. We're visiting with Greenville Drive general manager Eric Jurinko, and there is ball four. That is a two-out walk issued by Darden. You talked about the $8 million in renovations done last year. That was part of a wide directive by Major League Baseball. You had to do that. But what you've done in previous years and what you've done here are things that the drive have chosen to do to upgrade the fan experience and give people something new every year they come to the ballpark. And I know from experience, not every minor league team does that.
Yeah, again, credit to our ownership group for wanting to invest and reinvest in downtown Greenville and the ballpark. I mean, at our core, our business is about the fan experience. Our players are all employees of the Red Sox. They are assigned to us. We don't know how long we have them for. Yeah, sometimes we're fortunate where we can win a South Atlantic League championship like last year, but I joke with people as a general manager of a minor league baseball team, the next time the Red Sox ask me for any advice on a trade or a draft pick will be the first in 19 years. So it is all about that fan experience, and it's important to us to upgrade that every year and also keep our prices low. Again, going into 2024, haven't raised our ticket prices again, and our core concessions items have remained the same as well.
Thrower to first base and diving back is Wallace. It's one ball and two strikes on Jackson Hugus. Who designed the championship ring? Did you design that?
Yeah, and everyone's loved it. I may have gone a little overboard on those.
A little?
A little bit, yeah. I don't know if we're fortunate enough to win another South Atlantic League championship. I have no idea what we do on the next one because we can't go any bigger. Our vice president of finance has also told me I'm never allowed to design him ever again either after he got that bill.
Two balls and two strikes. It was a big moment for the franchise, just what, the second championship in franchise history.
Yeah, and an interesting path for the guys to get there as well. We had 16, over the course of the year, we had 16 of the Red Sox top 30 prospects. I think we had three by the end of the season. They had all been moved up to Double A. We won the first half of the season, which guarantees you a spot in the playoffs, but we did so by losing our last three games of the first half, then got swept to end the regular season in a six-game series, and then somehow the guys turned it on and swept the playoffs. So it's not the common way to do it, but it was exciting, and just the atmosphere on that game, championship game-clinching night here in September was just amazing, the atmosphere. I mean, talking with our manager, he said he never really got goosebumps before as a manager till that night.
Well, you know, it's interesting. Anybody who knows anything about development at the minor league level, we always kid Iggy Suarez, the manager, all the time because he doesn't do a lot of managing. They do all of the work before the game in getting players working on their hitting, working on their fielding, what they do. And then he writes the name in the lineup, and if it's their day to play, they're going to play. And there's very little pinch hitting, yep, any of that type of stuff. Until he got to the playoffs, and he told Tom Van Hoy, and I had that little twinkle in his eye. He said, I might actually get to manage a little bit. And sure enough, he can claim that, you know, he was the guy responsible for the victory.
Absolutely.
College baseball here at Fluor Field has been a staple basically since the park opened, but it just keeps getting bigger and better every year, with Michigan State being the anchor because of the relationship with Drive owner Craig Brown. But the quality of play we see here early in the season is just phenomenal.
Yeah, it's important to us to host these games for a variety of reasons. One is just a unique experience for the players, for the fans. I mean, there's a lot of fans in attendance tonight, or any of the amateur games that we host, that it's probably their first experience at Fluor Field, and we hope we deliver on a great experience. We're like, hey, let me come back and check out a Drive game. But it's been a busy spring for us. We've had, before the Drive home opener on April 9th, we will have had 25 amateur games, 14 different colleges play here. As you mentioned, anchored by Michigan State, who was here for back-to-back weekends. I'm obviously a Clemson alum, so always excited when we can have the Tigers here. We had the Gamecocks last night, USC Upstate. Had Florida State here for the first time, and they're off to a great start as well. Just was able to develop a relationship with Link Jarrett, the head coach there, when he was at UNC Greensboro, and he fell in love with this community as well and brought Notre Dame here when he was there and then brought Florida State. So it really is all about relationships.
Absolutely. Two balls, two strikes, two on and two out in the pitch. Big bounding ball up the middle, charging, and it gets through the shortstop, Hinderleiter, out into shallow center field for a base hit. Scoring from second is Wallace to tie the game at one apiece. Hugus comes around to third, and for Ryan Becker, that's his seventh run. Oh, they're going to charge Hinderleiter with an error. That's a tough scoring call. So no RBI, but the run scores anyway. And that's Hinderleiter's first miscue of the season. So an E6, runners on the corners for Holden Baker, who struck out his first time. And all of this, by the way, after the first two had been retired. Back-to-back walks to Wallace and Hugus, and then the miscue by Hinderleiter. And it's a 1-1 game here at the top of the third, and PC still with an opportunity to try and add more. Yeah, it's one thing to say we get college baseball teams in here, but the quality of teams you mentioned, you know, Illinois was among mm-hmm. the teams that was in here, Western Michigan, Western Carolina out of the SOCOM was here for one of those weekends. South Carolina was here against USC Upstate last night.
It was great to have like a team like VCU come down yes. with Bradley Lee, Croy, and Andrew Cox, and you know, being former Clemson guys as well, to have them back down here.
Yeah, so it's not just college baseball, yeah. but it's top of the line, nationally ranked college baseball. One ball, one strike, and the pitch. Slow bouncer to the right side, backhanded by Crichton. He will underhand to Darden covering, and the inning is over. But PC gets an unearned run to tie the game. Pitch the bottom of the third inning for PC is left-hander Luke Gibson, a 6-foot senior, 185-pounder out of Virginia Beach, Virginia, a Patrick Henry Community College transfer. And he will face 9-1-2, Purify, Mathis, and Overtop. And the first pitch to Jaron Purify is in for a strike. Gibson making his sixth appearance, all in relief, no record, a .675 earned run average. The 0-1, and Purify hits one high and deep left field. It is off the Green Monster, bounding back toward the infield. Running it down is Jay Weatherington, and Jackson Purify into second base with a leadoff double. That is his third two-base hit of the season. Off the bat, I thought that one had a chance to get out of here, and he got under it just a touch, but still had enough lift to get it off the Green Monster. And that's the go-ahead run at second with nobody out for Alden Mathis, who struck out looking, leading off the Clemson first inning. So Luke Gibson in hot water out of the chute, and Mathis pops one up on the right side. Hobson, the second baseman, on the grass, backing and over toward the line, makes the catch. And there's one down. Jeremiah Hampton went an inning, no hits, one run earned, a walk, and two strikeouts. You know, you can move back up here if you want to. Young budding broadcaster named Brady Bowman, who is job shadowing for a while tonight. Throw back to second. Look out. They almost got Purified. Diving back, hands first, got in just ahead of the tag by Hobson. Overtop struck out looking his first time up. And Gibson's first pitch to him is just off the outside edge, ball one. Just to follow up on what Eric Jarenko said, single game tickets and season tickets for the Greenville Drive available. And get it at greenvilledrive.com. Another throwback, and this one not so close. It was a good time. It's good quality baseball. And there was a lot of discussion over the major leagues putting in the pace of play rules for the first year last year. Well, minor league baseball had done it the year before, and it's really changed the game again. and I think changed it for the better. And you won't hear me say very many positive things, if anything, about MLB Commissioner Rob Manfred. There's a fly ball back into center field. Dragoo going back, still going, looking up, and that one is gone. Jimmy Overtop to the left of the scoreboard, flexing his muscles and going the other way for his fifth home run of the season. And Clemson allowed this season. Now Blake Wright, who walked his first time up, and he takes it outside of ball. College baseball, as most fans know, has added the pitch clock, but they don't have the other pace of play rules involved. That one's hit high and deep. Back into right field. Wallace to the warning track. That one is gone. Blake Wright going the other way. His eighth of the year. Back-to-back jacks for the Tigers, and they lead it 4-1. 23 runs batted in for Wright. Dropped that one into his own bullpen and straight away right field. And Gibson being greeted rather rudely here in the bottom of the third inning. Now here's Bassetta, and he tops one, first base side, charging as Baker underhands to Gibson covering and got him in a bang-bang play at first, two down. Set of running hard out of the box, but Gibson right where he was supposed to be, covering the bag, and they are two down. And now here's Will Taylor, who struck out looking, leading off the second inning. 4-1 Tigers here in the bottom of the third. And the first pitch to Taylor's in the dirt, ball one. But getting back to the pace of play stuff, in the minors going back 2 years ago, this will be the third year, second year in the big leagues, the limit to what they call the number of disengagements that a pitcher can make for every batter equals exactly two. So he can either throw over to first base twice, throw over once, step off once, whatever equals two. Two balls and no strikes and a curveball drops in. He can throw to first base a third time, but if he doesn't pick the runner off, it's a balk. And then along with that, the shift has been banned. That one airmailed to the backstop, 3-1. And you'll see players at the pro level take it right to the edge, shortstop almost directly behind the second base bag, but not quite. Back at the edge of the dirt. You can't be on the outfield grass like Hobson is now. There's strike two called on the inside corner. And it's just brought the other aspects back into the ball game. I was suspect of it at first. I have become a huge fan. And what's interesting to me is the minor league players and coaches, especially ones who'd been at the big league level, all thought that they would hate it. They love it. And I think in the big leagues, most of the players have found out that it has made the game more crisp. Two out walk to Taylor. And here is Hinderleiter, who walked and scored in the last inning. And he leans away from a fastball down and in, ball one. Bynes, the home plate umpire, checking something with the catcher, Jackson Hugus. Throw to first base, and stepping back to the bag is Taylor. And he began with Purified doubling off the wall in left field. Mathis popped out to second, but Overtop two-run home run to the left of the scoreboard in right center, 3-1. And Blake Wright followed him up with a solo shot to straightaway right. His eighth of the year, 4-1 Clemson. Two balls and no strikes on Hinderleiter. Pitch. And he rockets one off the glove of the third baseman, Lazio, into left field for a base hit. He hit the daylights out of that ball. Stopping at second is Taylor. And the inning will continue for Cooper Blauser, who drove in Clemson's first run of the game in the last inning with a sacrifice fly. Two on, two out for Blauser. Freshman DH tonight for Eric Bakic, and he takes a strike on the inside corner. Gibson with the pause. And he bounced that one up there. Rolls away. The catcher, Hugus, can't find it. And moving up to third base is Taylor. That'll be a wild pitch. I think we may have the early leader in the clubhouse for the long-distance viewer of the game, and one that's going to be tough to beat. Dave Estes and his wife are watching from Vicenza, Italy. Ground ball top foul, far into the third base dugout. He's stationed with the Army JAG Corps. He said, not sure if you remember me, but I remember spending Friday nights in the booth in 2004 at Serene Stadium when you and my dad called Greenville High School football games together. Throw to first base and back hands first is Hinderleiter. You know you're getting old when you're getting emails from the sons of people that you know. It's kind of a similar situation. I was down on the field earlier and ran into former Tiger Phil Pohl, pitching the dirt, who is back with the program in a support role, along with another former Tiger, Ben Paulson, who spent quite a bit of time in the professional ranks. Two-two pitch. And a ground ball to the right side. Hobson back at the edge of the grass, throws him out, and the inning is over. Phil and Ben were run, two walks and a strikeout. Aaron Hobson will lead it off, and the first pitch from Allen, he shortens up the bunt and offers at it and misses strike one. Hobson singled his first time up. There's strike two called. Say hello to Bill Davis, 1966 Clemson grad. Says he's watching on the computer from snowy Monument, Colorado. Swing and a miss. Breaking ball. Three pitches. Good morning, good afternoon, and good night. One down. Good start for Allen. Here's the number nine hitter, Eli Lazio, who walked his first time up. Say hello to Greg, who also wants to say hello to his parents, Phil and Jan Tompkins, in Mount Pleasant. One ball, one strike on Lazio. Richard checking in from Charleston, South Carolina. Strike two call. My buddy Ryan Troutman has got us tuned in tonight. Ground ball to third. Big hop for right. And his throw right on the money. Two down. So two quick outs for Allen. That's how Ethan Darden started the last inning, but then back-to-back walks and an error produced a run before he got the final out. The leadoff hitter Jay Weatherington has struck out swinging both times up. He fouls this one away, strike one. Say hello to Lindsey Bell and Doug Holliday in Lawrence. Bunt third base side. They will let that roll foul. No balls and two strikes. So Allen trying to do something that no pitcher for either side has done yet in this game, and that's retire the opposition in order. Clemson on top. 4-1 here in the top of the fourth inning. Tigers with the shift on. Three infielders to the right of second base. And a ground ball towards second. There is Purify, gobbles it up, throws him out. And the Blue Hose go quickly and quietly here and didn't strike out anybody. And the only man who did not bat for Clemson in the third will lead off the fourth, the eight hitter Jack Crichton. Saint will work from the windup, and the first pitch is outside, ball one. From the stretch, and just off the plate outside. One ball and one strike. Say hello to Ty Vines. And then also the folks from Easley American Legion Post 52 Baseball. One of their former players, Jacob McGovern, made his college debut for Clemson last night against Winthrop. There's a strike, 3-1. Michael Lacer watching from Lubbock, Texas. Trey Wellborn. Lee Lance, Rob Key. There's a rocket back into left field, but getting a good jump on it. And running it down was Jay Weatherington. For the first out of the inning, Crichton hit that ball hard. Now here is Jaron Purify, who doubled leading off the last inning and scored on the two-run home run one out later off the bat of Overtop. They really like this kid. Freshman from Detroit. Of course, Bakich, very familiar with that area. He came to Clemson from the Michigan program, where he was a head coach there and highly successful for a number of years. So dipping into his old stomping grounds and pulling out Purify. And there's a ground ball by the mound, and it gets through for a base hit. Just out of the reach of the shortstop, Brody Farr, ranging to his left, and Purify is 2-for-2. Coming into the game, the production that the freshman had put out was pretty impressive. He had driven in 15 runs in just 37 at-bats. So he is a one-out base runner. And Mathis skies one out behind second base, where the shortstop Farr will reel this one in, and there are two outs. Alden Mathis 0-for-3. And now Overtop, who struck out looking in the first, but then hit his fifth home run of the season out of here to deep right center field, the other way, just to the left of the scoreboard. His last time up. Throw to first base, and getting back just ahead of the tag was Purify. Ishiel Saints trying for a scoreless fourth inning. Two outs, a runner at first, bluffs to go, and the pitch is taken low and away. Runner goes. The 1-0 is a cue shot foul over by the first base dugout. One ball and one strike. See if he's running again. He is. Breaking ball taken for a ball. The throw down short and unable to handle it was second baseman Hobson. Wouldn't have mattered anyway. Purify got a great jump. Got in easily. That's his second stolen base of the year. Perfect 2-for-2. And he's in scoring position with two outs and a 2-1 count on overtime. Saint, a backward glance at second, pitching, and he had a good cut at a fastball and fouled it straight back. Two and two. Now Overtop asks for time, has something in the eye. He'll step out. Came into play tonight with a .529 on base percentage. Actually, that was coming into play last night before their game at Winthrop, or with Winthrop at Doug Kingsmore. Pops this one foul out of play. And obviously had a good night last night. .528 the on base percentage coming into play tonight. Slugging at .574. And he has added to that slugging percentage with the two-run home run his last time up. You know you're getting on base a lot when you have been on base 50% of the time tonight, and that causes your percentage to go down. 2-2 pitch. And a smash foul between the bag and coaching box at third. Holding it 2-2. Blake Wright waiting on deck. Ishiel Saint trying to strand that runner at second base. 2-2 pitch. And he missed with a breaking ball low. Overtop started to go, held up. And now a 3-2 pitch coming to Overtop from Ishiel Saint. Here it is. And he walked it, bounced it up there. So his first walk. And now Blake Wright. This is a guy that you want at the plate in a run-producing situation so far this season. 394 with runners in scoring position. His two-out batting average drops to .214, but he's having a fine year. Hit his eighth home run of the season last time up, and he hits this one a ton. Back into left center field. Dragoo to the wall. Forget it. Gone. Three-run home run for Wright, his second in as many at-bats. And Clemson has opened it up here in the fourth at 7-1. That's now nine home runs and 26 RBIs on the season, counting his production tonight. My, how things can change. You're a pitch away from getting out of it. If you're Yashil Saint, you end up walking over top. And then Blake Wright takes you downtown. 7-1 Clemson. One ball, no strikes to Tristan Bassetta, who's 0-2. And that breaking ball in the dirt. 2-0. Just off the outside edge. Three balls and no strikes. So, tell you what, it promises to be an entertaining series this weekend at Doug Kingsmore Stadium when Florida State comes in. They turned Bassetta loose on 3-0, and he was trying to hit one to nearby Travelers Rest. 3-1. Florida State undefeated, 18-0. It's like the old days in the ACC when those teams got together. Ground ball right side, Hobson to his right, backhands, and he throws out Bassetta. He was way in the hole, sprinted across. I'm sorry, this is actually Brody Farr. 2, 3, and 4, Farr, Dragoo, and Wallace. First pitch, ball one. This is the only game involving an ACC team tonight. Tuesday is the big midweek day across college baseball. One other game involving a Big South team, Gardner-Webb, on the road at Charlotte, and they are trailing 3-1. Top half of inning number 5. 3 balls and a strike. Farr has walked, he has struck out, and he has walked again as Allen misses inside ball 4. So the leadoff man aboard. And now is Joel Dragoo, who has walked, grounded to short at 2 times up. Say hello to longtime pal Chris Langley here in Greenville, South Carolina. Mark Crane watching down in Charleston. No balls and a strike. Big bounding ball left side, picked by the shortstop Hinderliner. Gets the force at second base on Farr, and that's all. 6-4 on the out for the first out of the inning. And Dragoo now the runner at first on the fielder's choice. Rogue Wallace, who has flied to center, walked and scored at 2 times up. Left-handed batter, actually a switch hitter, batting left-handed, and takes a strike. The 1-0, good breaking ball, swung over the top of it. 1-1. Talked at the top of the broadcast about the offensive issues Presbyterian College is having, hitting 248 as a team coming in, and how their pitching staff has gotten knocked around here tonight. By and large, their pitching has been good this season, a staff ERA of 373 coming in. It's going to be interesting to see what they can do once they get into Big South play. Strike on the outside corner, a backdoor breaking ball, 2-2. You weren't with us. Amon Dewberry and Trey Fenderson, two of their frontline guys out for the season, and Jack Gorman injured, working his way back. He was taking some ground balls today in hopes of getting back soon. But Dewberry and Fenderson out for the year. Gorman started the first 11 games but hasn't played since. It's really taken a chunk out of Elton Pollock's expected offense, but their two frontline starters, their Friday and Saturday guys we talked about a little earlier, Daniel Egan and Charlie McDaniel, are going to give them a chance to win a whole bunch of series in Big South play. Swing and a miss on a good off-speed breaking ball. Wallace is down on strikes. Two down, second strikeout for Allen, and here's Jackson Hugus, who has struck out and walked in two times up. And a ground ball by the mound. There is Hinderleiter, the shortstop, gliding to his left. Underhands to Purify to get the force on drive. 5.56 batting average with five home runs, 15 runs batted in, and has scored 13 runs. That, folks, is a good month for most people. He's done that in seven games. Strike one swinging to Will Taylor, who's walked and struck out and two times up. Takes that one in the dirt. One pitch. Good overhand breaking ball that got the outside corner. One and two. Bit of a breeze picking up here. It's been blowing fairly consistent out towards right center field. Nothing major. Ball fouled off the foot of Taylor. He leaves the bat lying across home plate as he walks off the stinging in his foot or his knee. May have gotten him in the left knee. Whoever it was, he is in some discomfort. Home plate umpire Doug Vines giving him time to get it shaken out. Now he'll step back in. Smith with the 1-2 pitch. And that breaking ball didn't. It stayed up and in. Two balls and two strikes. Break-even pitch. And a high fly ball. Weatherington can't find it. He's going back to the warning track. Now he locates it and he makes the catch. The lights are on. That ball got up, I'd have to think, above the light standards. That was way up in the air, and for a terrifying moment, Jay Weatherington couldn't find the baseball, but he located it and made the catch on the track, and Will Taylor just missed that one. One down. Jacob Hinderleiter's been on both times. A walk and a run scored and a base hit. And he takes a breaking ball for a strike. Swing and a miss. That one ricocheted off the catcher Hugus and into the third base dugout. 0-2. Tanner Smith, the fifth pitcher of the night for PC, and he overthrew that fastball and destroyed an anthill a couple of feet in front of home plate. Ball and two strikes. 7-1 Clemson. They got a run in the bottom of the second. PC tied it in the top of the third. That ball is hit well into right center field. Wallace on his horse, not going to get it. One hopping off the wall, bounces over his head. Here comes Hinderlinder into second base. He'll stop with a two-base hit. He's on for the third time, and he is in scoring position with one down. That's his fourth double of the season. Clemson got three in the bottom of the third. Two-run homer by Overtop, followed by a solo shot by Blake Wright. And then Wright, a three-run bomb out of here in the fourth inning, and that's where we stand right now, 7-1. Cooper Blauser, a sacrifice fly and a ground ball to second in his two trips. Chance to drive in another run here. Smith's first pitch on the outside corner, a strike. The 0-1. Fouled it straight back over our head. It'll clear the roof and get out of here. Blauser coming in, we mentioned earlier, 16 at-bats prior to play tonight, so he's not had a lot of opportunity. And sometimes stats tell you things and sometimes they don't. 0-2 pitch, mouse it up there. For instance, he has a zero batting average with runners in scoring position. But the sacrifice fly that drove in the run doesn't count towards that batting average because it's not an official at bat, but it produced the run, driving in Clemson's first run of the game. 2-2. Hinderlinder out at second base with one down here in the bottom of the fifth inning. And again, he bounces a fastball up there. It's three balls and two strikes. Pitches from the extreme first base side of the rubber. The payoff. Strike three swinging. How about that? After overthrowing back-to-back fastballs, he comes back breaking ball and had Blauser way out in front on the swing, two down. First strikeout for Smith. And now Jack Crichton, who has struck out looking and lined out to the left fielder Weatherington his last time up. 3-33 batter with runners in scoring position, and that pitch in the dirt outside, ball one. Swing and a miss. One ball and one strike. Of course, the big news around the ACC in general and Clemson specifically is Clemson filing a lawsuit against the Atlantic Coast Conference this week. Fly ball to right, moving toward the line is Wallace, waiting, and the inning is over. They joined Florida State in doing so to try to get out of the conference. An opponent's hitting 333. Against him. Joe Allen, two innings, no hits, no runs, one walk, two strikeouts. Very good out of the bullpen for Eric Backich tonight. Here's Ryan Becker, the number six hitter, leading it off for PC in the sixth. 0-for-2, reached on an error his last time up, and that produced the only run that the Blue Hose have in this game so far, with Rogue Wallace scoring from second base on a ball that Hinderliner couldn't handle out at shortstop. First pitch, a strike, swing and a miss. And it's quickly 0-2. Working from the stretch full time. And the breaking ball down. Bassetta straight away in right, but Taylor in left and Matheson center shading him the other way towards right. The 1-2. Strike three swinging. Fastball up. Becker goes down, and a good start for Olenchuk. Look at that 12 earned run average, and I don't know how he's looked in previous games. I do know that early in the season, when you've only had three appearances and three innings, it doesn't take a lot to skew your ERA. That thing can come down in a hurry with a couple of good outings. Here's Holden Baker, first pitch swinging. He fouls it off to the left. I'll tell you what, a good crowd has made its way into Fluor Field here tonight. I think it's going to be a stretch to say we're going to be above the 1,852 that we had here for South Carolina USC Upstate last night. One ball, one strike. Baker is struck out swinging and grounded out. First baseman pitcher covering, and he's backing away and takes a strike there. It's 1-2. My good friend Bill Lanham watching the broadcast this evening. 1-2 pitch. And it's fouled over the screen up toward the hillside. Third base side. I was correct about the attendance. 2,744, the announced crowd for this evening. 2,744. 1-2 pitch. Just missed the inside corner. See, when the minor league season gets here, if things are like they are every year, the Greenville Drive is going to be at the top of the South Atlantic League in attendance. Swing and a miss. Good breaking ball down and in. And Baker, second straight strikeout victim for Olenchuk. Two down for Aaron Hobson. Drive averages over 5,000 fans a game for its 66 home dates. And it's not uncommon for there to be 6,000 or 7,000 fans in here over the course of the summer. Hobson 1-for-2, and that one clears everybody, ball one. Singled in the second, strikeout swinging in the fourth. Clemson on top, 7-1 as we play here in the top of the sixth inning. Olenchuk delivers, and he buzzed the tower with that one, two balls and no strikes. While Clemson is heading home this weekend for its second ACC series against Florida State in the battle of, you might say, the conferences now two rogue programs. And I think they would wear that title with great pride. Presbyterian College will begin Big South play this weekend, going on the road to Longwood. 3-0, and he walked it, missed badly outside. So a two-out walk to Hobson keeps the inning alive and allows the number nine hitter, Eli Lazio, to come to the plate. He's walked and grounded to third and two times up. And again, Big South Conference play opened last week, but UMPC had the conference bye on opening weekend. They lost a three-game set to George Washington last weekend. So they'll hit the road to Longwood this week. And Clemson coming off of winning two out of three on the road at Duke. As mentioned, at home for Florida State. All right, here's Lazio, Olenchuk. Ready to go to work on it. And he bounced that one up there, ball one. It's five straight out of the strike zone after back-to-back strikeouts of Becker and Baker to begin this top of the sixth inning. And ball two. 2-0. Seven straight out of the strike zone for Olenchuk. He walked Thompson on four straight. He is 3-0 on Lazio with the leadoff hitter Weatherington waiting on deck. And he walked him. 8 straight out of the zone. See if that's going to get pitching coach Jimmy Bellinger out of the dugout. Some moving around down there, but nobody coming out, and now an offensive conference between Jay Weatherington and his head coach, Elton Pollock. These two teams first met back in 1906. And now here comes Eric Backich making the slow walk out to the mound. And Weatherington has struck out, and grounded to second. First pitch is swung on and fouled back. Give me that email address one more time, drivebooth@yahoo.com. I'm interested to see if anyone can top Dave Estes, our long-distance viewer leader in the clubhouse right now, watching from Italy. But wherever you're watching from, we'd love to hear from the 0-1. Fisted on the ground, left side, cut off by Wright. Running throw, and he got it. That is a nice play, because if Wright doesn't get it, and the shortstop Hinderleiter has to come in and make. First batter he will face is Jaron Purifi, who has doubled and scored and singled and scored in two times up. Takes the first pitch for ball one. Shows bunt, and that one came in and got him. Did it get the bat or the hand? Well, it got at least part of the hand. Now they're going to ask, did he go after it? And first base umpire Craig Barron says he offered at it. So it's a painful strike for Purifi, who's still shaking it off. And now Eric Backich going to come out, and he wants to talk to home plate umpire Doug Vines. And meanwhile, the trainer going to come out and look at Purifi, who is still shaking that hand out. You just have to hope that he's just got bees buzzing in there, because the upside for this young man is something that the Clemson staff is extremely excited about, and starting to build some momentum in that lineup. You'd hate to see it short-circuited by something like this. So Backich continues to have a leisurely chat with Doug Vines while they tend to purify. Looks like he's going to stay in. Getting the batting glove back on. Still shaking it out. But he's going to step back into the box. And it's one ball and one strike to him. Settles back in. And the 1-1 is grounded towards the shortstop, Farr, who gobbles it up and throws him out. And there's one down. So we'll keep an eye on Jaron Purify. See if maybe he comes back to the dugout and they look at him again. Here's Alden Mathis, a leadoff hitter who's 0 for 3 tonight, a strikeout and a pair of pop-ups, one to second, one to short. And he swings and he hits one high and deep. Right field, goodbye, gone. First pitch, his third of the season. A no-doubter about 10 feet to the left of the pesky pole and way out of here. His 11th RBI, it's 8-1. That is the fourth home run that Clemson has banged out tonight. Giving them 41 now on the season. And here's Obertop. He has one of the home runs, a two-run shot back in the third inning. And, of course, the guy on deck, Blake Wright, has left the yard twice. The 1-0, breaking ball strike. That's the first run that Boykins has allowed all season long. And now 7 1/3 innings. The 1-1. Swing and a miss. Chase the fastball away. And that one's low. Two balls and two strikes. The walk Obertop received in the last inning, and that pitch misses outside. 3-2, or his last time up, I should say. His 27th of the season, and this Clemson's 20th game. There's ball four, so make it 28. He's a one-out base runner. And what you like is walks are running ahead of his strikeouts. 28 walks and now 21 strikeouts. Here's Blake Wright. Walk, solo homer, three-run shot. And he started to go, tried to hold up on a breaking ball and couldn't. Strike one. And he lines this one into left field, but right at Weatherington, who makes the catch, and there are two down. Well, he stung that ball. And now Tristan Bassetta, who's 0 for 3. Ground ball right side, but there is Hobson back on the grass, and he throws a one hop that Baker digs out at first base in the inning. If we go the distance, and the first pitch to Brody Farr is down and in, ball one. Farr has walked twice and sandwiched in between a strikeout swinging. Fouls that one off to the left. One ball, one strike. And that one got him. Far on for the third time. And here's Joel Dragoo, who's 0 for 2 with a base on balls. Swing and a miss on the first pitch. Outside, one ball and one strike. Just a pleasant night here in Greenville, South Carolina. 74 degrees at game time, still 64. There's a strike call, one and two. Eric Jerinko, the Greenville Drive general manager, mentioned that Clemson will be back here again on April the 2nd to face USC Upstate. Ball fouled off. Look out. Right up above us. And then someone made a nice catch down below. It was off the catcher's mitt. And it hit right above our window here and dropped back down into the seats. And that's significant because in 5.5 years of doing the Greenville Drive, Tom Van Hoy and I have not had a foul ball come into this booth. There have been windows shattered on both sides as Dragoo strikes out swinging. But our time is coming. You can just feel it. Tom would be with us tonight, but he and his family are enjoying Greenville County's spring break for students. There's Rogue Wallace, 0 for 2 with a walk and a run scored, and he swings and fouls at left side. Say hello to Scott Simpson. Watching us from the greatest city in the world, where I will be, God willing, next week for opening day in Cincinnati between the Reds and the Washington Nationals. Swing and a miss. 0-2. I introduced Mrs. Scott to everything that is opening day in Cincinnati last year for the first time. I've been there 10 or 11 times. She is now hooked. 0-2 pitch. Just missed the inside corner. Everything from the parade forward. Ball and two strikes. One on, one out for PC here in the top of the seventh. And that one is fouled out of play left side. Titsworth ready with the 1-2 pitch. And the breaking ball is lifted foul. And that will get out of play to the hillside. And the scrum is on. Line drive, left field. That will be played on a hop by Will Taylor. Gets it back to the infield. That's just the second hit of the night for PC, but they have had runners all over the place this evening. The aforementioned 10 walks and now the hit batter to begin the inning. Coming in to play this inning, they had stranded 9 runners on base. 2 on, 1 out. Jackson Hugus is 0 for 2 with a walk. In each of the first 2 innings, they left runners at second and third. Had an opportunity to do some damage early, but could not. That pitch misses ball one. And the traveling man, Barry Thrasher at Fort Leonard Wood, Missouri, out there for his son's graduation from the Army, or for the Army, I guess. Got us dialed in. Two balls and no strikes. And ball three. Overtop tried to bring it up, but Doug Bynes wasn't buying it. There, strike one. Three balls, one strike. And strike two called on the inside corner. This one foul down the right field line, and that's going to nestle back into the seats. Two pitch, grounded to short. That could be 6-4-3 on a hop. Inning is over. Purifies throw bounced over there, and he's still shaking that hand a little bit as he comes in effect. So Clemson could end this game early with 3 runs here in the bottom of the 7th inning. And of course, Carty is thinking, no way. First pitch to Taylor is outside of ball. Big sweeping breaking ball from the sidewinder. Taylor 0 for 2 with a walk. And that one gets through to the backstop 2-0. He just missed getting one out here his last time up. He got under one. Jay Weatherington in left field couldn't find it initially, but then ended up making the catch on the track towards the left center field end of the Green Monster. That breaking ball in for a strike. And there's strike two. Break-even pitch, way outside with that frisbee. It's 3 balls and 2 strikes. And ball four, he walked him. So Taylor on via the base on balls for the second time, and that's how the 7th inning starts for Clemson. Thank you. Jacob Hinderlinder, who has been on all three times, a walk and a run scored in the second, singled in the third, doubled in the fifth. And that pitch just off the plate outside, ball one. Quick throw over to first, and diving back to the bag is Taylor. Off-speed pitch in at the knees for a strike. Clemson going for its third straight win and 13th in its last 14 games. 18-2 coming into play tonight after their win over Winthrop last night. Ground ball to second. That should be two. 4-6-3. Pretty as you please, and they are two down. Hobson to Farr to Baker. I want to talk about an insane stat. For Presbyterian College, that is just the fifth double play they've turned all season long. The one they hit into in the top of the inning, the 22nd. Usually don't see that kind of disparity. Such is life right now. Strike one to Cooper Blauser, who's 0-for-2 with a sacrifice fly. He drove in Clemson's first run way back in the second inning. There's strike two called at the knees. It's 0-2. Bottom of the seventh. Clemson in control, 8-1. They have flexed their muscles tonight to the tune of four home runs. Two of them off the bat of Blake Wright. Ball and two strikes. Ground ball to second. Hobson and another throw in the dirt, but it's scooped by Baker and the inning is over. And with Ryan Becker due up, we're going to have a pinch hitter. Evan Cuervo will come off the bench to swing the bat in the DH role to begin this eighth inning. Cuervo, a sophomore from Tampa, Florida, went to Steinbrenner High School. Yeah, that's Steinbrenner. Shot knocked down by Clayton, runs toward third baseline to pick it up and throws him out. Good reflexes and a good reaction, and Cuervo denied what likely was going to be a base hit. So 1-3 on the out of Cuervo, and here's Holden Baker, the first baseman, 0-for-3 with a pair of strikeouts. Clemson pitching, we mentioned they've walked 10. They've also struck out 10 tonight and allowed just two hits. If Clayton were a hitter, you would say that he pitches with a closed stance, front foot in front of the back foot. When he comes set, the batter can see the number 20 on his back. That pitch is low. Three balls and no strikes. We're in the top of the eighth inning. Third-ranked Clemson Tigers on top of Presbyterian College, 8-1. There's a strike. Started to talk about this earlier and got interrupted, but these teams first met back in 1906. Clemson leads the series 68-23. There's ball four. But of those, only 16 have been since Presbyterian College joined the ranks of Division I. Here's ball one to Aaron Hobson, who's 1-for-2 with a walk. That's going back to 2008, and Clemson leads it 12-4. Flair, shallow right. That is going to drop in front of a diving Bassetta, who got a glove on it. Couldn't reel it in. Stopping at second is Baker. And the bloop single by Hobson. The Blue Hose have two on with one out for Eli Lazio. And now Hobson has two of their three hits. Lazio has walked, grounded to third, and walked again. Takes it inside, ball one. They had two on in the last inning, but Titsworth got Jackson Hugus to ground into a 6-4-3 double play. Clayton misses downstairs, 2-0. Right-hander brings it, swing and a miss. Eli Lazio's lone home run this season came this past weekend in the second game against George Washington. That's outside, 3-1. That one back. Three balls, two strikes. Runners at first and second, one down. Presbyterian College trying to get something going here, trailing in the top of the eighth inning, 8-1. Payoff pitch, and he stays alive with another foul ball. Baker, the lead runner at second, Hobson at first. Again, the 3-2. And he lifts this one in the air, but foul off the screen down the right field line and ricochets out into short right. So a pretty good battle developing here between Clayton and Lazio, and another foul. He will try it again. And guess what? The face-off continues. We were here, I think it was 2 years ago, for a Greenville Drive game, and a catcher named Eli Marrero had a 20-pitch at bat in which he fouled off, I believe the total ended up being 18 pitches or something close to that. Lazio not in that stratosphere yet, but continuing to battle. Again, the 3-2. And a ground ball to third. Right will go to the bag for one. Wind up and let it fly. Double play. Inning is over. 5-3. On the twin killing. Jaron Purify is going to be taken down. And first pitch swinging, a big bounding ball to short. Off the bat of Tristan McClatty, and Farr throws him out. And very quickly, two down. I just wonder if that hand is still bothering Purify, where he got hit back in the sixth inning trying to bunt, stayed in the game, completed the at-bat, and ended up making a play in the field the next inning, but pinch hit four here. And now here's Alden Mathis. One for four, homered his last time up, and he tries to bunt his way on, and he strikes, he misses at strike one. So McDaniel's dreams of a three-pitch inning go by the board, and there is another rocket. Hit high and deep, right field, to the scoreboard, gone. Alden Mathis says, Blake Wright, you can leave the yard twice, so can I. It's 9-1. He doubled his home run output on the season here tonight. He had two coming in. He's got four. And now 12 runs batted in. Jimmy Overtop struck out looking the first. Since then, a two-run homer, a walk and a run scored, and another walk. First pitch is high, ball one. First home run that McDaniel has allowed. PC had allowed 14 home runs coming into play tonight. And that is five that Clemson has hit in the game. Two by Wright, two by Mathis, and one by the young man at the plate, Overtop. Two balls, no strikes to him. The 3-0. And he takes it high, ball four. First walk issued by McDaniel. Seventh by PC pitching. And now here's the aforementioned Blake Wright, a walk, a solo homer, a three-run homer, and the last time he lined out hard to Wetherington in left field. And Overtop is going to be taken down. And running at first base will be Devin Parks. But imagine someone will replace him because he's listed as an outfielder and somebody's going to have to go behind the plate. Right, first pitch swinging. Fouls it off to the right. Both of his home runs have gone the opposite way. The first one just to the left of the scoreboard out in deep right center field. No, I'm sorry, the first one dropped into the bullpen and straightaway right. The second one was to the left of the batter's eye. It was Overtop's home run when they went back to back that was to the left of the scoreboard. One ball, one strike. Pitch high, 2-1. Got the first two outs on two pitches. Crichton grounded to second, pinch hitter McClatty to short, but then Mathis, his second home run of the game. Overtop walks, Parks pinch runs, and now the one or the 2-1 will have to wait as McDaniel throws to first base. 9-1 Clemson. And another throw over. Ball three. 3-1 to Blake Wright. Pitch. And he hits it hard, but foul just outside of third. Three balls and two strikes, so with two down, Parks will be in motion from first base. Nine-1 Clemson here in the bottom of the eighth inning. The runner goes, and a high drive way back. That's three of them for Blake Wright. Straight away left field, and that's the ball game. His third home run of the night, a two-run shot. It's 11-1, and Clemson has officially run.